In this video, I'm going to show you the strategies that I like to use to understand any recursive code, even when I don't really know what's going on. This is super important because we need to understand all of the code that we're going to be looking at, and there's so much that we can learn from other people if we understand how their code works. But if you don't understand how to read recursive code and how exactly it's working under the hood, you're not going to be able to be successful with this course. So watch this video and I'm going to teach you exactly how to do that. This is, as I said, understanding any recursive code is critical to your understanding of the course. And it's critical to be able to trace through that recursive code and understand the order of operations. This is one of those things where it's kind of annoying because the order of the code on the screen is not exactly the order that it's actually getting executed necessarily. And you need to know what order things are happening and how they're interacting with each other so that you can figure out what's going on effectively. The way that we're going to do this is by drawing the recursive tree and tracking the variables. What that's going to allow us to do is it's going to allow us to keep track of exactly where we are, and it's going to allow us to really understand what's going on. And that's super important. We do this so that we can make sure that we keep track. And as you're going through recursive code, you want to be absolutely sure that you're writing everything down and keeping track as you go so that you can remember exactly what is going on. So the reason for doing this is, you know, for one, obviously, I want you to understand everything in the course, but really it's because exposure to real-world examples is the best way for you to get used to these patterns. And everyone is going to have like a different idea of how to approach these different problems, and everyone's going to do slightly different things. So looking at what other people are doing is huge. It's basically like a theme and variation. The idea here is that since different people do slightly different variations on the theme, you want to be able to truly understand what they're doing, and then you can learn how to apply those themes in your own code. So let's look through a couple examples of this, and I'm going to walk you through how to do this. Basically, what we're going to do is we're going to sketch out a tree structure. So I'm going to start with, we're going to calculate for Fibonacci number 4. I'm going to say, you know, I'm going to just abbreviate stuff a little bit to make it easier, but we'll just say f of 4. And now I'm going to draw this as a tree. So we're going to walk through our code. We're going to say, okay, n is currently equal to 4. So it's where n is not equal to 0. It's not equal to 1. So I'm going to come to here. And I'm going to call fib of n minus 1, which in this case is 3. Now you might think that we would go straight to adding f of 2 over here, but that would be completely wrong, actually. And the reason for that is that before anything else happens, we need to compute this value. And that's the whole point of this. We want to understand what the order of operations is. So before anything else can happen, we need to compute this value. And to do that, we need to come back to here. So fib of 3, it's not equal to 0, it's not equal to 1. So we go again, we get f of 2. We're going from the same spot. And again, we need to compute this before we can compute, before we can come back. So we're going to do f of 1. And we're going to get, okay, now to compute f of 1, we see, okay, we hit our base case, which was 1. And so we're going to return 1. Now that we've returned, we're back here. We know that we already computed f of n minus 1. So we need to do f of n minus 2 now. We're going to do n minus 2, which is going to be fib of 0. And this, we also, now we compute, we hit our base case, it's equal to 0, so we return 0. Now we've computed everything here. So now we've basically replaced these functions with actual values. So this gets replaced with 1, and this gets replaced with 0, and so we can actually compute this value, so we return 1 here. And now we're back where we started again. So let me erase this. And we're back at f of 3. We already did this one. And we evaluated it to 1. And now we're going to come here and we're going to say f of n minus 2, which is going to be f of 1. This is our base case, so we return 1. and then this evaluates, so this evaluates the one, and then 1 + 1 = 2. So we return that, which is 2. And we do the same thing on the other side, right? So we're going to say f of 2, and we need to compute f of 1, which is going to be equal to 1, and f of 0, which is going to be equal to 0. And then we add them together, we return 1. And now, finally, we get that our return from this is 2 + 1, which is 3, which is what we expected. So as you can see, by doing this as a tree and by writing everything out as I go, I can easily keep track of where the recursive functions are so that I can understand what's going on. And you're going to get a lot of chance to practice this in the homework for this module. But let's look at a couple more examples. So this next one is a problem that we talked about already. We talked about reversing a linked list, right? So again, I'm going to write my function call. So I'm going to call it f. And in this case, I'm just going to put the number of the, like we're going to use this linked list here. And I'm just going to put the number so that it represents the node. So like this f of 1 means f with this node. And so f of 1, if the head is not null, so we go to here, we call f, we call head.next, which is 2, so we do f of 2. Then we, it's not null, head.next is f of 3. Head.next is f of 4. And remember, this is the same thing where it's like every time we hit that recursive function, we need to evaluate the recursive function before we do anything else. So we haven't printed anything at this point because we keep hitting this print and we have never returned yet. So finally, we come down, we do f of null. And that's our base case, so we're going to return. So we return up to here. And now head is equal to 4. And we just returned back at this point. So now we print head, which is 4. So we print 4, we return back again. We return to this same spot, we print 3. We return again, we print 2, we return again, we print 1. And so we have our linked list printed out in reverse order. Now, one more problem that I want to go through, and I want to just explain the problem so that you understand what we're doing first. And this is going to be our, this is like our core pattern for the selection problem, but it's finding all combinations or finding a power set. And so in this case, all combinations of 1, 2, and 3, we do have the empty list as a valid result, and then every other result is some combination of, is some unique combination of 1, 2, and 3. So here's our code. I'm not going to go into the code because I want to show you that even without understanding the code, we can still work through this. So we're going to start with combinations of 1, 2, 3. We come here. We're going to initialize a new list. And so we have some results. And that's going to be equal to the empty list. And now we're making our recursive call. So we're going to have, I'll just reuse this. So we're going to have I equals 0. I equals 0. And our path, which is going to be equal to an empty list. So we come here. We say I is not equal to n dot length. So we continue down. We create a new list. So we're going to say path with current. So I'll call that PWC equals new linked list. This is just copying our path as a new linked list. And we're adding the current item. So we copy this empty linked list, which was path. And we add a new item, which is I, which is 0. So in this case, we add 1. And notice how I'm writing down all of my variables. This result is defined out here, so I'm keeping it sort of off to the side. And this is defined within my combinations function down here. So I'm putting it in here with it. So now I'm going to say, okay, I'm going to make two recursive calls. I'm going to start with combinations. So combinations pass, or f in this case, because I'm just using f as a generic function of n, which n is going to be the same regardless, so I'm not going to write it again. You don't need to write the variables if they're constant the whole time, or in this case, I'm not going to write results in there. I'm only writing the things that are relevant and changing. But I plus 1 is going to be 1, and path is going to be equal to this. Now I come back here, I say, okay, I'm not at my base case. I am going to create path with current. So path with current is going to be equal to 1, this path, plus the current one, which is now 2. So 1, 2. And then I'm going to make this recursive call. Actually, sorry, I did this wrong, right? Because we should be calling with path and not path with current. So I should actually go back a second. This should be an empty. This should be empty, right? We need to be careful that we're passing the right thing. So we're passing the empty one, then our path with current here is the empty one, but then we add 2 to it. So we get this. And now we're going to recursively call again. So we're going to say f2 and empty list. And then we come here, we create our path with current is going to be equal to the empty list. And then we're going to include our current, which is 3. So it's just going to be this. And then finally, we are going to make one more recursive call. So we're going to say f(3) and the empty list. And now we see, okay, I is equal to n.length. And so we add this path to our results. So I'm actually going to move my results somewhere where they're a little bit more accessible. So I'll put down here. So we'll say results. And so we're going to add our first thing to the results, which is this, which is the empty list. And that was one of our valid combinations, right? So now we are going to, we hit our base case, so we return back. So we return back here. And then we're going to return to this point. So we call combinations pass, and this time we're passing path with current. So we're going to say f3, and we're going to pass in this path with current, which is 3. And so in this case, we are going to have, we are going to now hit our base case again. And so we're going to add this list to our results. So we're going to put in this right here. And then we're going to return. Now we've done both of these. We got to the bottom, so we return again. And then we're going to do path with current. So we're going to say f(2), and this is path with current. So 2. And now we have 2 options. Our path with current at this level is equal to 2, 3. And we can either do without the path with current, so with the old path, which is just f(3, 2. And we add our 2 to the list. I'm moving a little faster now because there are a bunch of these different combinations, but I'm just doing the same thing in my head. Or we can call with path with current, so f(3, 2, 3. And that gives us 2, 3 in our result. We return back all the way to the top now. And now we're going, so like you see, basically we generated all the combinations that didn't include 1. And now, because we included 1 in our path with current, we're gonna do all the combinations that do include 1. So we get f(1, 1), f(2), and you know, our path with current is equal to 1, 2. So path with 2, 1, path with current equals 1, 3, you get F 3, 1. We add this to our results. We get F of 3 and 1, 3. So we add that to our results. And then finally here, we're going to get, I mean, we don't have to, well, I guess we can do it. F of 2, 1, 2. So this way, we're going to get F of 2 of 3 and 1, 2. So we get 1, 2. And then our final result is going to be this, which is going to be F of 3 and 1, 2, and 3. And with that, we return all the way back up to the top, and then we're done. So that's how we compute all of the combinations using, and how we actually sketch out the work. So unfortunately, I apologize, it's a little bit messy. It's a little bit hard for me to draw on here, but I would highly recommend that you do this on a sheet of paper, because doing it on a sheet of paper is going to give you the, is going to make it easiest for you to, one, keep it clean, and two, like, keep track of everything that's going on, and it's going to give you just such a better sense of how this problem actually works. So here's just a, you know, a cleaner sketch of what that actually looks like if you want to be able to refer back to it.